humans affect the environment in so many ways. One of the great tragedies of our age is how we treat our oceans. The Vancouver Aquarium has taken leadership to better understand our aquatic environments and change human behavior so these essential ecosystems can be healthier. And they have been sharing this knowledge with other countries. I know that when Lynn and I went to China, we were surprised to find the level of involvement of our Vancouver Aquarium in conservation efforts there. Our next guest is playing a vital role in the mission to help our oceans and our rivers become healthier. Please welcome Dr. Peter Ross.
I'm the guy you probably don't want at your Friday night party because I'm the guy that always brings up the bad news. And this is, it's always interesting to me because I love the world around us. I'm curious, I'm science oriented, I'm a researcher. I've been studying living forms since I was a wee boy. And I love to get into what makes animals tick or the non-human animals tick. So when I look at the ocean, I look at something that is magical, mystical, mysterious. I see the deep abyss that is fundamentally foreign to most of us in this audience. And I see something beautiful, something I can scarcely understand. So as the bad news guy, I want to understand the ocean around us so that I can inform ideas that might nurture, protect, recover, conserve, and enable things that will help to preserve species for future generations. So if I look at the charismatic species that we have off our coast, the southern resident killer whales, the northern resident killer whales, the Biggs killer whales, these animals drive me crazy with bad news. I'm the guy that discovered our killer whales to be the most PCB contaminated marine mammals on the planet. And that was close to 20 years ago. And I worked for a federal agency and they went, oh no, here he is, Dr. Doom, he's coming with more bad news about yet another chemical. We thought we banned that one. I said, yeah, you did, but there's a legacy. And yeah, you did, but there's another chemical, a flame retardant chemical you haven't dealt with. Yeah, you did, but a lot of the salmon that the residents rely on swim through waters where we use up to 500 different agriculture pesticides and forestry pesticides. So we're dealing with some bad news that's out there. And in looking at the bad news, I find shining hope. And you may know that the ocean covers 70% of the planet. It produces 70% of the oxygen we breathe. Fundamentally important to us as a species, and yet we scarcely understand it. We've got hundreds of thousands of species that have been documented, probably millions out there, most of which we haven't yet identified scientifically. Did you hear the news that 11 kilometers down in the Marianas Trench, a deep sea dive in October 2018 found a plastic shopping bag? 11 kilometers down. I did a media interview after that story came out, and the reporter said, where did it come from? And I said, from us. It came from us, and this is the challenge we face with plastic. So I'm going to link the ocean that we're trying to understand and trying to protect to us and what we're doing in our homes every day. Did you know that when you wash a polyester fleece sweater that we love and cherish in this city, you can lose up to 10 million fibers in a single load of laundry? 10 million polyester fibers going out the back end of your washing machine. Shouldn't come as a shock because you all regularly, routinely clean out the lint trap in your dryer. We don't have a lint trap in washing machines. So they end up heading out there through the wastewater treatment plant and where we've been doing work with MetroVancouver. Our plastics lab has been studying this phenomena. Three pictures of what's coming out of the back end of our test washing machines from different items of clothing. We find clothing, all types of clothing sheds fibers and they're getting into laundry and into the effluent and out the door. This larger image is a sample of seawater from False Creek. This is what we're finding in the ocean. We're finding colorful fibers, all between 11 and 15 microns thick, and many of them fibers. So many of these particles are fibers. In the neighborhood of 75% of the microplastic particles we're finding in the ocean are fibers. We're finding them in Arctic seawater. Lower concentrations, but still upwards of 90% fibers, most of it polyester. This is what we're seeing in the ocean under the microscope. Red, blue, pink, yellow, green, fibers. They're everywhere. In our study with Metro Vancouver, published last year, we showed that the largest wastewater treatment plant in Vancouver is receiving 1.8 trillion particles of plastic every single year. 70% of these are fibers, colorful fibers. The good news, 99% are retained. The bad news, we're still losing, through that single plant, 30 billion into the ocean every single year. And the 99% that we retain are not destroyed. No, they're better understood and managed, but they are then used as fertilizer in agriculture, mining reclamation, and forestry fertilization efforts. So there's some good news in understanding and advancing our understanding of this issue, and that gives us a chance to intervene, and that's fundamentally important. What does this mean? Well, in 2015, we showed that one in every 20 individual zooplanktons at the bottom of the food chain, two species in the North Pacific, had plastic in their belly. One in every 20 invertebrates, and we don't know how many had died from plastic or had passed the plastic, but they were encountering plastic, and most of these were fibers in coastal waters. We're finding fragments of plastic in salmon returning from the open ocean. Where they're picking up that plastic is subject of intense interest, and what it means is, of course, troubling. We can talk about our beloved charismatic killer whales and how plastic might move around their habitat and get into their food supply. And we really have to ask another question that is in the news today, and that is, what does it mean for us humans? So there are studies that show that we humans are being inadvertently exposed to plastic through bottled water, other beverages, our food, aquatic species, and our indigenous communities along coastal British Columbia consume 15 times more seafood than the average Canadian. 15 times more than the average Canadian. The Inuit, 25 times more. So the ocean is more important, in my view, to our indigenous coastal communities. And that's something that we have to pay attention to. The good news about this is, from my perspective, we can take the bad news and wrap it into a good news story. Because the bad news is the science, the discovery, the knowledge that gives us insight into sources and consequences. If we have information on the consequences, that tells us our government should be regulating the issue and industry should be paying attention. And if we have insight into the sources, we can turn off the tap. And turning off the tap is what we have to do with microfibers. And this is where everyone in this room can get involved, because we don't blame industry on this one. We partner with industry. We partner with homeowners, school kids, wastewater treatment plant engineers here in Vancouver, cities around the greater Vancouver area. And individuals. There are many things that we can do on the plastic file, and I'm a fervent believer in the power and the value and the relevance of research to inform the solutions. The trick is to close the loop on the plastic economy. Right now, 91% of plastic is going into landfill every year. We need to close the loop and create an economic valuation through opportunities therein. $150 billion a year is the throwaway single-use plastic value every single year. Innovation, economic opportunity, and solutions will offer many entrepreneurs in this room the chance to close the loop on the plastic economy and reduce the release of all of these plastics, including fibers, into the environment. Thank you.